Amen. Well, let's go ahead and get started this evening. Let's grab that hymnal and turn to page number 341. 341. Amen. Let's stand and sing, Whosoever Will. Amen.
Whosoever here is, shout, shout the sound. Spread the blessed tidings all the world around. Tell the joyful news wherever man is found. Whosoever will may come. Whosoever will, whosoever will. Send a proclamation over land and hill. 'Tis a loving Father calls the wonder home. Whosoever will may come. Whosoever cometh need not delay. Now the door is open, enter while you may. Jesus is the truth, the only living way. Whosoever will may come. Whosoever will, whosoever will. Send a proclamation over land and hill. 'Tis a loving Father calls the wonder home. Whosoever will may come. Whosoever will, the promise is secure. Whosoever will, forever must endure. Whosoever will, 'tis life forevermore. Whosoever will may come. Whosoever will, whosoever will. Send a proclamation over land and hill. 'Tis a loving Father calls the wonder home. Whosoever will may come.
Amen. Oh, we're so glad you're here. Excited to see what the Lord's going to do. And thankful for that. Thankful for Sunday. Thankful for the good reports at Life Signs Baptist Church. I'm sure Preacher will say more about that. I'm thankful for that. If you're a visitor tonight, we welcome you to our church. We're so thankful that you're here. And if you have not received a visitor card, if you'll raise your hand, we'll get you one to you. Anybody like that here tonight? No, you're not a visitor. So, good try, good try. You can't have a cold beverage mug. So, perfect. Well, we're glad you're here. And excited to see what the Lord's going to do. And let's pray. Heavenly Father, we thank you for today. We thank you for your goodness. We thank you for the opportunity to meet here and open up your word. And Lord, I ask you to edify us tonight in your son's name. Amen. All right.
I guess we have the fellowship song now, yeah?
All right. Let's stay standing. And
amen. Calisthenics. Amen. Get your exercises. Page number 278, 278, please. And let's sing about that one day. 278. Amen. It's all good. One day is coming. There we go. You got it. There we go. One day when heaven was filled with his praises, one day when sin was as black as could be, Jesus came forth to be born of a virgin, dwelt among men. My example is he. Living, he loved me. Dying, he saved me. Buried, he carried my sins far away. Rising, he justified freely forever. One day he's coming, oh glorious day.
Amen. Fellowship a bit. Amen.
Amen. Let's jump in on that second verse. One day they led him up Calvary's mountain. One day they nailed him to die on the tree. Suffering anguish, despised and rejected. Bearing our sins, my Redeemer is he. Living, he loved me. Dying, he saved me. Buried, he carried my sins far away. Rising, he justified freely forever. One day he's coming, oh, glorious day. One day the grave could conceal him no longer. One day the stone rolled away from the door. Then he arose, over death he had conquered. Now is ascended my Lord evermore. Living he loved me, dying he saved me. Buried he carried my sins far away. Rising he justified freely forever. One day he's coming, oh glorious day. One day the trumpet will sound for his coming. One day the skies with his glories will shine. Wonderful day, my beloved one's bringing. Glorious Savior, this Jesus is mine. Living he loved me, dying he saved me. Buried he carried my sins far away. Rising he justified freely forever. One day he's coming, oh glorious day. And he is, amen.
All right, great to see everybody here. You may be seated. Grant, go ahead and make your way up here. We will have our kids class tonight. Tonight we'll be discussing the altar. Why do we have an altar in church? And I'll start off by telling you a funny story about that I heard over this weekend. Brother Crabtree says, thank you so much, church. He was thrilled that I got to see what's going on there outside of Columbus, Ohio. Very, very, the area is just growing. And in fact, the town and the area he's in is just an amazing testimony. I'm sure many of you are aware of it, of the church they got, the building they got, and a very successful businessman who gave them a loan, an interest-free loan, and they have 5 years to pay it back, and they've already paid a third of it back. And in 1 year with this deaf church, and the Lord's just doing some miraculous things. And so he said, thank you. And then I got to see the Caspers, too. They were here for the weekend because he laid flooring for them all week, and they kept them over. And some of the big money contributors to their projects over the last few years, 4 years, were also present, so it was a great service. The previous record was 101, and they had 148 Sunday morning, and I would say probably 50-50 deaf and hearing. Probably half of that was deaf, so we rejoice and praise the Lord. And I know I made a little video. It was an eventful Saturday, praise the Lord. But thank God for our youth conference, all those that worked. I know we said thank yous a lot. From what I heard, I think there was at least five saved, possibly six. We're thankful for the teenagers that got saved and for the work that went into it. And we praise the Lord for all that he did. So, all right, tonight we'll be discussing the altar. We'll be splitting up into four groups, and I'll give you that in just a second. And we're going to discuss the altar. Last week we talked about prayer, and so we're going to continue on that. Why do we have an altar? Why do we have an altar call? And why should we use it from time to time? And we're on the series of now, why do you do that, right? A lot of churches don't do that. A lot of churches have gotten rid of their altars. They don't have them anymore. They don't have the altar call. And I'm just going to say it. I'm very proud of our young people. They use it very regularly. And I hope you guys never outgrow that. I really do. And I don't want to ever outgrow that. Brother Pope, every time he preached, I stopped at the altar before I came up to help. But I love to be at the altar when someone preaches the Word of God. And there's just something about it. It's an Old Testament principle. One of those biblical principles that continues all through the Bible. So we'll talk about that in just a little while. So great to see everybody here. Good to have visitors here. As always, at this time, Grant's going to read our missionary letter. Then we'll have our special. And then we'll dismiss the kids and go on with our service. So great to see everybody here. Thank you.
the Johnson family from Lithuania. Resurrection Sunday. This year, we were able to celebrate Easter 2 weeks in a row, the Lithuanian and the Ukrainian Easter, which are 1 week apart. As of now, Lithuania has received just over 50,000 Ukrainian refugees. God has blessed us with four different families visiting the church, and we are doing all that we can to be a blessing to them. The shirt my wife is wearing in the above picture was handmade and given to her by one of the refugee ladies. Baptism. In March, I had the opportunity to baptize this lady named Vida. Please pray for her and her husband Jonas that he too would get saved. The Easter Egg Hunt. This is the group that participated in this year's egg hunt. We have not been able to do this activity the past 2 years because of COVID restrictions. We met at the church for a simple Bible lesson about the death, burial, and resurrection of Jesus. I was so proud of our ladies as they gave a clear presentation of the gospel to the kids and to the many parents that came. After the lesson and a light lunch, we all went to the local park for the Easter Egg Hunt. Ukrainian refugee relief. Lisa and I have been amazed to see how God is providing for this new ministry opportunity. Not long after the refugee crisis began, several generous churches and individuals contacted me and wanted to know if they could give financially to help care for the physical needs of these displaced people. To date, we have already received $21,727. If you or your church would like to give financially to help meet these needs, you can send offerings to my sending church designated as Ukrainian Refugee Relief or through PayPal. Contact me for instructions on how to give through PayPal. Following is a summary of expenses thus far. 125 packets of food at $30 each, equaling $375. $3,750, a used refrigerator equal $110, three used adult bikes equaling $400, two burner electric stoves equaling $30, medications and vitamins equal $75, and kitchen supplies equaling $150. As of now, these funds are being used by our church in Utena and by the Christ Mission Baptist Church in Kaunas. This Friday, the church in Kaunas is planning to give out 100 packets of food at $3,000. Here in Utena, we are registering people to give up packets of food on May 7th. We will also be giving out used clothes. I have a friend that owns a used clothes store, and he gave us an entire vanload of used clothes this past week to be used for refugee relief. We will continue to do all that we can as finances become available. I will include several pics in our MailChimp mailing. If you would like to receive our email updates, please drop me a note letting me know at skidmaze@startmail.com.
All right. Revelation chapter 3. Revelation chapter 3. Pray for our missionaries. Praise the Lord for that. Revelation chapter 3. If you take your Bibles and turn there, Revelation chapter 3. And I'll read a few verses here for all. We'll read them all together. And then Brother Robbie's going to come sing for us tonight. Miss Marissa's on the piano. Appreciate that. And then we will dismiss our young people and split up into groups. I'm going to be daring tonight. We're going to split up into very in groups. We're going to see how it goes. I'm going to be daring in our group split up. You'll see in just a second. Look at verse 14. Brother Pope talked about this on Friday night when he preached that powerful message on the white stone. If you've never heard the biblical preaching on the white stone, you should listen to Friday night's message. It was phenomenal. And he talked about the Laodicean church. He believes the same way I do about, or I believe the same way he does. He believed it first before me, about how these were seven literal churches that were around in the day that John wrote this. They also represent, I believe, seven church phases, or some say church ages. And you can find these seven churches even in with each age and each stage. But as a whole, you can categorize them a lot of times by what's going on globally. And this is the last church, the seventh one of them. And Laodicea was a place. I don't have time to get into it tonight. I've preached on it several times through the years. I've preached on Laodicea quite a bit about why their water was lukewarm and why God used that as an analogy that made him sick to his stomach and he spewed it out. Most of us like our drinks either hot or cold, not lukewarm. But Laodicea also means the rights of the people. And we're definitely living in that day and age. The church has become very self-centered as a whole, and we're not as thoughtful of others, if you will. And maybe that has something to do with the altar, and we're going to talk a little bit about that tonight. But let's look at verse number 14 and read down through verse 22, and then have our special, and we'll split up in our groups and go from there. Verse 14, "And unto the angel of the church of the Laodiceans write these things, saith the Amen, the faithful and true witness, the beginning of the creation of God. I know thy works, that thou art neither cold nor hot. I would thou wert cold or hot. So then because thou art lukewarm and neither cold nor hot, I will spew thee out of my mouth, because thou sayest, I am rich and increased with goods and have need of nothing, and knowest not that thou art wretched, miserable, poor, blind, and naked. I counsel thee to buy of me gold tried in the fire, that thou mayest be rich, and white raiment, that thou mayest be clothed, and that the shame of thy nakedness do not appear, and anoint thine eyes with eye salve, that thou mayest see. As many as I love, I rebuke and chasten, be zealous therefore, and repent. Behold, I stand at the door and knock. If any man hear my voice and open the door, I will come into him and sup with him, and he with me. Let me stop real quick before I read the last two verses. This was one of the pivotal problems of the church of Laodicea. Everybody preaches about all the other things that's going on in the previous verses we read, but this is, I think, the big problem. God was concerned about the lack of response. Response. If I say to my kids, do something, and they don't respond, there's going to be a problem, right? Response. Christians are still supposed to respond to the things of God. And if Jesus is knocking on our door, we better answer. And I think that's one of the problems we have in society today, in our churches today. To him that overcometh, will I grant. By the way, did you see what happens if you do respond to him? You get to sit with him. You get to sup with him. I mean, that's pretty awesome when you think about it. To him that overcometh, will I grant to sit with me in my throne, even as I also overcame and am set down with my Father in his throne. He that hath an ear, let him hear what the Spirit saith unto the churches. All right, Brother Robbie's going to sing for us, and then we'll dismiss the kids. Great to see everybody here tonight. Thank you.
Here I am, Lord, and I'm drowning in your sea of forgetfulness. The chains of yesterday surround me. I yearn for peace and rest. I don't want to end up where you found me. And it echoes in my mind, keeps me awake tonight. I stand before you now. I know you cast my sin as far as the east is from the west, and I stand before you now as though I've never sinned. But today I feel like I'm just one mistake away from you leaving me this way. Jesus, can you show me just how far the east is from the west? 'Cause I can't bear to see the man I've been rising up in me again. In the arms of your mercy I find rest. 'Cause you know just how far the east is from the west, from one scarred hand to the other. I start the day the war begins, endless reminding of my sin. Time and time again, your truth is drowned out by the storm I'm in. Today I feel like I'm just one mistake away from you leaving me this way. Jesus, can you show me just how far the east is from the west? 'Cause I can't bear to see the man I've been rising up in me again. In the arms of your mercy I find rest. 'Cause you know just how far the east is from the west, from one scarred hand to the other. I know you've washed me white, turned my darkness into light. I need your peace to get me through this night. I can't feel by what I feel, but by the truth your word reveals, I'm not holding on to you, but you're holding on to me. You're holding on to me. Jesus, you know just how far the east is from the west. And I don't have to see the man I've been rising up in me again. In the arms of your mercy I find rest. 'Cause you know just how far the east is from the west. From one scarred hand to the other. One scarred hand to the other. From one scarred hand to the other.
Thank you, Robbie. Thank you, Miss Marissa. Kids, you are dismissed. You are dismissed. Thank you, young people. Let's see. Branson's preaching tonight. Brent's a worker. Appreciate our workers going down with our young people. Appreciate Brother Hurst leading singing on Wednesday nights, and praise the Lord for that. All right, here we go. I want to get right into this evening. So we're going to split up into four groups. The deaf will stay here, and then we're going to go by beverage tonight. If you love coffee, you're going to be as far away from me as possible in that far corner over there. And then we'll do tea drinkers over here and milk drinkers here. We got to go with milk, right? Milk, it does a body good. I'm not going to say water because water's in tea. And they claim water's in coffee. I don't know. I don't have a hard time believing. I have a hard time believing water wants to be around coffee because God made water. But anyway, so we'll do that. Coffee, tea, and milk, and we'll split up in these three groups. But let me tell you a funny story about the altar and invitations to get us thinking about this. Now, I didn't grow up in churches that had altar calls and invitations regularly. I remember when I first came into an independent Baptist church, I thought that was something different. Every service, they would give an invitation. And I always liked the word invitation. I thought that was a good word. If somebody was having a party, it was always nice to get an invitation to it, or a wedding, an invitation to it, or a graduation. I get a lot of graduations this year from teenagers I preach to all across the country. And usually it means, Brother Randy, send me money. It doesn't mean I really want you to be here. Just send money, right? Same as a wedding invitation, right? Now, obviously, there's some wedding invitations you got to be at, but a lot of times they're just saying, send money, right? We'd rather your money be here than your body, right? But an invitation is a blessing. God is an inviting God, right? God is an invitation kind of a God. And so I remember when I first got into the church, I began to ask questions like that. My pastor did a great job of answering it. And it may fall into one of those traditional categories of things that we do. But listen, again, as I said a few weeks ago, not all tradition is bad. Jesus talked negatively of traditional things. But then in other verses, he talked positively of it. And Paul himself bragged on the traditions of the elders at one point in the epistles. It's when the traditions conflict with God's word that they're not good. But I like traditions. I like Christmas traditions. I like the 4th of July traditions. I like certain traditions that we have as Americans. There's certain traditions deaf people have. There's certain traditions the black culture have that the white culture has. And different, the Mexicans, my brother-in-law, I've learned a lot about the Mexican culture and traditions. They have nothing wrong with that, right? But why do we have an altar call? Why do we give an invitation? Why? What's the purpose of it? So discuss that amongst your group. But this past Sunday, I happened to be around a couple of men that are very successful. They've been very successful financially and blessed. And they're very generous with their money, too. They're very generous. I learned there's a lot of people that are generous with the church's money, but they're not always generous with their own personal money. Somebody say amen right there. It's a blessing when they're generous with their own personal money, and that's how these men are. And I met them and talked to them and everything, and so... That evening, Brother Crabtree and I were fellowshipping a little bit, and he was talking about some of those men he's crossed paths with, and he has been around a lot of them. I'm like, man, you really are a moochinary, Brother Crabtree, man. You have had money thrown at you, man. I said, man, I've never had that, you know, in my ministry, and God's good. We all have different things and stuff. But he told me a story about how there was three very successful businessmen, and he named two of them. I knew two of the three. I did not know the third person. And I did not know this about these three men, but once a year they would gather in Florida. These three men would meet in Florida for about 3 or 4 days, and they would discuss their home churches. They would discuss needs of missionaries. They would discuss needs of local churches, kind of like what the church planning conference does. And then they would, as a group, would contribute to those needs. I thought that was great. And then they would go play golf or do some fun things those few days. Now, by the way, one of them is in heaven now. Two of them is actually in heaven now, but the third one's still alive, I believe, is what Brother Crabtree was telling me. So... But what they would do when they would go to Florida, they would always try to find a new church to go to, a new independent Baptist church, these three men. And when they would go to that church, they would find a new independent church, and they would try to go to that church. They would try to be a blessing to that church while they were there. That's just something. They would just sneak out and leave, and they didn't want their name attached to it. That's the kind of men these are. And on their way, this one particular night, on their way to the church service while they were having their meeting in Florida, the one of them said, you know, the Lord's really laid in my heart. I want to buy a car for a preacher, and I'm just feeling led to do that. And I may do that tonight for this preacher. I may just do that. And the other two friends are like, you're going to buy him a brand new car? Yeah, I'm just going to buy him a brand new car tonight. And the two men were like, wow, that's really generous. That's great. He goes, what are you two going to do? He goes, we don't have to do anything because you're going to take care of that for us. And so they pulled into the church parking lot, and they went in, and they were part of the service. They met the preacher. They got back in the car and started to drive away, and the man that promised to give money to buy a car said he didn't do it. And they were driving down the road a little bit, and the other two men spoke up and said, hey, I thought you were going to buy him a car. He said, no, I'm not buying that preacher a car. And they said, why? He said, I'm going to buy somebody else a car, but not that man. They said, why? He goes, because he didn't give an invitation. And I already knew I always wouldn't give an invitation, but after I heard that story, I'm going to give an invitation the rest of my life no matter what. Because if you happen to be here tonight and you want to buy me a car, I will give an invitation tonight just for that. No, that's not the reason we do it here. But it was a blessing to hear a man believe so strongly in that. Why? Why would a man believe so strongly in that? And by the way, the preacher never found out he could have got a car that night if only he would have given an invitation. Now, he doesn't know that. The preacher, I don't even know who the preacher was. They didn't tell me who the preacher was. But the point of the story is this. It meant a lot to somebody. And can I just tell you, before we split into groups, I have made life-changing decisions at an altar in some church somewhere. I got saved at an altar. I decided I was supposed to marry this lady to my left right here at an altar. I got called to preach at an altar. I got direction from God at an altar. And by the way, the direction to be a pastor was not at a church altar. It was actually at an altar outside of church. We're going to talk about that today, the individual altar and the corporate altar. We may talk about this, and they all go with prayer too. So why is the altar important? Why is it neat? Why do we sit back sometimes as the older folk and say, oh, that's great, the teenagers are going forward, but we don't always move to the altar. I'm not one of those guys that think Christians should come every service. That's between you and God. But if you never use the altar, you should probably check yourself a little bit. There's a purpose to it. Why? And maybe you don't know the real reason for it. Well, I'm going to show you tonight. I'm going to show you from Revelation 3 why it is an important concept or an important activity of our church. And by the way, can I let you in on a little secret? One of the driving reasons your preacher does not preach long like many preachers do is because the invitation and the altar to me is as important, if not more important, than what I just said for the last 20 minutes. And I have watched many of my preacher friends, they should have landed the airplane, the teens were about to respond, people might have gotten saved, but they went an extra 20 or 30 minutes longer, and they lost the crowd. And nobody came forward. And afterwards, like, man, I can't believe nobody came forward. And sometimes I'm close enough with them, I'll say, if you'd have shut up 20 minutes ago, they were ready. I thought you should have shut up 30 minutes ago. And I'm a preacher, right? And I'm not saying that. It's not my place to judge, but I've observed that. I've been around a long time. What happens here is so important. And that's why, as long as I'm the pastor of this church, we will always have altar calls. We will always have invitations. But maybe tonight we should figure out why. So, all right, coffee drinkers, go to this corner. Go ahead. Tea drinkers to that corner. Milk right here. And Def, you have your own discussion. Why? Why do you think we should do altar calls? There's no wrong answers. Why do you think an invitation is important? Water. Water or soda? What do you want? Water or soda? Tea? What about Kool-Aid? What about Kool-Aid? All right, the deaf are naming their group water. So the deaf are going to be water. They protest. Look at all those heathen people in that left corner back there, man. God help us. Wow, our church needs help. Some of my own family are in there. I think I drink beer before I drink coffee, amen. I see you. All right, pick a spokesperson, and we have plenty of time tonight. And then we'll have four groups. So why? Why do we have an altar call? Why do we do invitations? And go ahead and have a discussion on that, all right? I think I'm coming down to the milk group. He's going to the bathroom.
Thank you.
Got about a minute or two, and we'll gather back. One minute. All right, let's go ahead and gather back together and send the spokespersons up here. Thank you. Milk and tea, it was tough. All right, let's go ahead and start with the deaf this time, and then we'll go to the coffee, tea, and then we'll close with milk. So, spokespersons, come on up. So we'll start with the deaf. They called themselves the water group. So they were the water group. All right, here goes the deaf. The deaf said the purpose of the altar is... that is where a lot of times you can feel connection there, and you can feel inspired in pursuing a relationship with God. Like, in other words, because of a decision I made at the altar, I can now continue it outside. By the way, the altar can be any place. It's not just one particular place. You can actually have an altar anywhere. And then also, sometimes a sermon or a message can challenge you and you're showing the Lord that you're thankful for that thought or challenge, and you're expressing that thanksgiving by going to the altar. It's a good place for repentance. You can have a repentance there, and that also deepens or widens or broadens your relationship to God. And then also at the altar is a good place that I can go to just give God notoriety for how good he really is to us or how he's been to me personally. And like we mentioned a lot of times, sometimes we feel stress, anger, frustration. The altar is a good place to leave it there. You can say, Lord, can you help me? Here at this altar, I'm leaving this load, and I want you to take this burden from me, and I want you to control my life. I want to fight against anger and all that stuff. Also, sometimes the altar is a good place to ask for a specific need, and you can remember it there, and it's also a great place for forgiveness. You can also pray for others at the altar. It's a really good place sometimes in the altars to pray for others in need. And prayer for support at the altar is a great place that we can do that. It's a really good opportunity for us to focus on our relationship with God. Amen. Good. Water. That's first. Good job. All right. We're going to go ahead and get coffee out of the way. Thank you.
All right. Well, we had a big group because, you know, coffee's the best. But anyway.
Help. That's the way the world is majority.
Anyway, we had a lot of good things said, so I'm just going to read through them here, and we'll go with that. So the altar is a good place to stay humble, coming before the Lord, and it's kind of like baptism in a sense. You're letting people know and also just humbling yourself before the Lord that you're there to make a decision. It's a place where major prayer requests can be answered. It's a place to be closer to God. It's a holy place. A decision requires action, and if you don't, if you're just sitting in your pew and you're convicted about something, it's good to just take the action and go to the altar. It's a place where you can, it's a tool that you can use for keeping a soft heart to God. It's a place where you can leave your burdens at the altar. it can be an encouragement to others, kind of like preacher says, when he's calling an invitation and somebody raises their hand. He's happy to see when somebody raises their hand because that means they're not alone. So it can also be an encouragement tool. The altar is necessary. So it's a place of worship as well. So it's different than praying in a pew because, like I kind of already said, it's professing that to the Lord, staying humble, and coming before Him with open hands. It's where you go when God moves you, and then lastly, it's a good place to thank God for coffee. So.
All right, we were the small tea crowd, and wasn't too many of us, but used to do before Christ died in the Old Testament times for sacrifice, so it used to be a place of sacrifice. That's a good symbol for here. Good self-check, and checking ourselves, and symbolic of a humbling time of yourself and surrender to the Lord. And this was an interesting take. I really enjoyed this. Old Testament, they were commanded to tear down wicked altars. So we need to do some serious thinking that when we go, is it for the right reasons? And I like that.
I had the milk crowd, so go milk. One of our things was lay it all down at the altar. Another one was to make decisions, not only to fix your decision or to whatever, but just to make decisions. Humble yourselves to get right with God, a place of worship. Go to the altar before, get your mind right, and your accountability, and get your account settled. So that's all I got.
Very good. All right. Danette, thank you all. That was great. Thank you. Danette said altar calls or invitations are vital to every church. When you take that first step out, it gets easier to walk on down. If God is speaking to you, you need to listen and respond. But I like what she says here. Taking that first step is tough, but it's better for a person to be on their knees if medically possible, because it says in the Bible that every knee shall bow. And that's a great statement. It's an honoring of God. So let me just give you a personal testimony of what it did for me. I'll never forget the first time I used it was probably the day I got saved. And I can testify with a lot of those people that if I've heard this many times through the years as a preacher, I've heard people say that have walked the aisle even in this church or at conferences and camps that I've preached at, they've said, I was sitting there and just something just said, you have to go. Something made me go. And that's what I've heard them say. Now, we know God doesn't make people go to the altar, but there's sometimes such a strong draw, and there's something about standing up and stepping out that just, it's the draw. It's the answer to the invitation. It's like, okay, God is inviting and inviting and inviting and inviting. And I had a similar experience to that. I remember not really understanding that I could have an altar everywhere, because I agree an altar can be anywhere. You can have an altar at your home. You can have it in a field. You can have it in your backyard. You can have it in your living room. You can have it in your basement. You can have it. The bathroom is a little bit of a tricky place. I probably wouldn't have an altar in the bathroom. But, you know, you can have it in just about any place. But I didn't know that you could get saved other places when I first got into this. I was a little confused about that. So I remember July 15th, conviction was really heavy on me that Friday. And I remember telling God, saying, God, if you'll let me live till Sunday, I'll get saved on Sunday. And I didn't realize I could have gotten saved right there. Maybe I did. I don't know. But, I mean, Sunday morning on July 17th is when I left the seat. And I got saved. I don't even really remember a whole lot about leaving the seat. I remember getting to the altar, like being there, but I don't remember that journey to that altar. And so I wanted to talk about it a little bit tonight because I think it's important for us. First of all, we have to remember that not many churches do that anymore nowadays. And so when visitors come, they see us doing that and responding. It's a little bit of a shocker to them. And I've been asked that many times by people, newer people, people that are considering joining the church. Do you do that every service? Why do you do that? What's the purpose of all that stuff? And I explained it to them. Let me just say that there's no right way to do it either, or right or wrong way. I know of a church right now that they've done things differently. They've actually taken a cross, and I actually like this idea, and they put a cross in the back of the auditorium, and they say, if you need to get saved today, go to the cross and someone will meet you. And instead of coming to the front, they get up and walk to the back to the cross, and there's altar workers there leading to Christ. It doesn't have to be here in the front. And I would never say that it is. That's where it is here. And as you notice, our building is designed for that purpose. The wood, it's appealing. It's a place that you can come and kneel and pray, or even sit on that lower step, or even on the second step if you're not physically able, or in the front row and stuff. So let me just talk about, first of all, why it's important to have an altar. The Old Testament saints, as was mentioned in our milk group, they built, I think it was Deborah said, they built altars. They built. And we're talking about some of the key Old Testament saints. Noah built an altar. Abraham built an altar. Isaac, Jacob, Moses, Aaron, and many others. Elijah was mentioned as well. In fact, there was a big battle of altars, because Baal's crowd had an altar too. And thank God, God's altar defeated Baal's altar that day. And the devil has an altar also. When you look at the definition of the word altar in the Hebrew and the Greek in the Bible, you're going to be shocked how it's defined. Almost every place it says altar is defined as altar. I love it when the Greek and the Hebrew do that. It's like, well, what's the purpose of looking it up? It's the exact same definition. But an altar is traditionally, it is something you build with your hands, and it is for a memorial. There is instances in the Old Testament, we don't have time to get into all that, where they recalled the altars they built. They rebuilt certain altars from yesteryears. Then there were bad altars that they had to tear down. I think Brother Bussy and the T group mentioned that. And the theme for our DBFA, National Deaf Conference, this coming June, and I'm closing the conference out on Thursday night this year, which is exciting. Brother Nick will be there. Brother Crabtree will be there. A lot of deaf preachers will be there from across the country. And the theme is build this year. And I was thinking a lot about what I was going to preach on that, and I thought, wow, maybe one of the reasons we don't build anymore is because we don't tear down things first. And that can happen at an altar. I look to my right now, and I'm just amazed. Friday night was one of the most amazing things in recent memory to me. I was just soaking it in I felt like a little kid, just couldn't believe what was going on. All those teenagers running around this gym, and we're finally in it, and it's happening, right? But that would not be there if we didn't tear down the old building first. And sometimes you got to tear down all things at the altar before you can build things at the altar. You can't keep building. There's no way you could have built this on top of the old building. It wouldn't have worked out. And I think Christians try to do that sometimes. So there's so many things that happen at the altar. There was decisions made at the altar in the Old Testament and New Testament. There was great sacrifices made at an altar. An altar was a place for sacrifice. We know about Abraham and Isaac, the story there. We know about how Isaac was replaced by a ram caught in a thicket. Thank God for that. We know about the altar. When it's all said and done, we know about the greatest altar and the greatest sacrifice is Calvary, a cross, where Jesus Christ built the greatest altar of all, because he made the trees that formed those crosses, and Jesus Christ hung as the ultimate sacrifice so that we can have eternal altars now in salvation. Thank God for that. But let me give you a couple of personal reasons why, because first of all, tonight, a lot of what we do in the Christian life is good individually and corporately. And let me just say this. When Christians begin to get closer to God individually, it contributes heavily corporately to the church. When the whole nation of Israel was right with God, they were blessed, right? When Moses left for a little while and they made a golden calf, they were not so blessed. They got in a lot of trouble for that, right? And so Moses had to come back down, and he was furious, and he broke the law, the tablets, right? And I heard an interesting statement about that recently from a preacher. He said, isn't it interesting that God wrote the first set of tablets, but once Moses broke those, he said, Moses, now you've got to write them. And that's why we've had to translate the Bible all through the ages. That was an interesting statement I heard the other day. I thought that was interesting. God had given him the first copy, and Moses kind of messed it up in his anger. I don't really blame Moses. Maybe many of us would respond the same way. But they became what the crowd was. Aaron had dropped the ball even a little bit there, and he succumbed to them, and he yielded to them. And so altars have a lot to do with that. Could I first of all challenge us as individuals tonight to make sure we have a daily altar with God, a walk with God, a time where we present ourselves to God. Romans chapter 12, right? I beseech you therefore, brethren, by the mercy of God, that you what? Present what? Right. As a what? Boy, thank God for that. The Old Testament, that's so significant in the Jewish realm, because in the Old Testament they sacrificed dead sacrifices, but we are to be presented as living sacrifices, right? Living sacrifices. I think the altar call is one of the biggest steps to closing the generation gap in our church. I am going to be talking to the men and young men this Sunday morning a little bit about closing the generation gap while the ladies are downstairs. And I've got a burden about that. I feel like there's too much of a generation gap. For some reason, people sometimes outgrow altar calls. They just do. I don't want to ever outgrow an altar call. Why is it wonderful for a 16-year-old boy to do it, but not for a 46-year-old man to do it, right? Do we get to the point where we arrive? At what point in our Christian life do we think, oh, that's not necessary? At what point will some of these young men who come almost every service, and I praise the Lord for that, But at one point, will they finally say, I'm just not going to do that anymore? Well, did it mean something then, and it doesn't mean something now? What happens? What was that dynamic, right? So it becomes a personal thing, a personal decision. I made a decision many years ago that if God speaks to my heart, I'm going to go to the altar. You know what I've learned? God speaks to my heart a lot. He really does. That's my personal decision. It doesn't mean everybody's supposed to do it, but I will challenge you to come on a regular basis or from time to time, at least, and here's why. Number one, you find out the truth about yourself. You find out the truth about yourself. Look at Revelation chapter 3, verse 14 again real quickly. And unto the angel of the church of the Laodiceans write, these things saith the Amen, the faithful and true witness, the beginning of the creation of God. Now, stop. If you back up and you read the previous six churches that Jesus is talking to, Jesus is completely honest with all of these churches. He tells them exactly what they do that's good. He tells them what they do that's wrong, and he tells them how to fix it. And you've heard me oftentimes say that if I go to the dentist or a doctor's office, I want them to tell me the truth. If my tooth's hurting here, my problem's not over here. There's something going on here, and the dentist has got to tell me the truth and fix it, right? And so this is what Jesus is saying. He says, unto the angel, this is for Laodiceans. This is what I'm telling you. Boy, I love the individuality of it. When Johnny Pope preached this past week, and when Brother Bussey closed it out on Saturday, I love to think of this concept that the blessed Holy Spirit flooded the invitation time. And he speaks to all the individuals differently. Friday night, when the first service happened and those teenagers got saved, he wasn't speaking to everybody about salvation, but he spoke to some. Because the Holy Spirit knew who wasn't saved. And boy, I love the boldness of a teenager so many times. It's amazing how a young person, sometimes their boldness in church just outweighs adults. It's amazing. Boom, the hand goes right up and they walk the aisle in front of 350 plus people and they got saved Friday night. Wow. Holy Spirit knew who to talk to about that. Thank God they responded. And boy, if a lost person can respond to salvation when God speaks, we need to do it too. You find out the truth about yourself. You know what I found out at the altar? I found out I was lost and I'm on my way to hell. I found out those baptisms weren't going to do it. I found out the sprinkling was going to work, and I got saved. Look at verse 15. I know thy works, that thou art neither cold nor hot. I would thou were cold or hot. So then because thou art lukewarm and neither cold nor hot, I will spew thee out of my mouth. Now here it is. Look at this. Because thou sayest, and here's what Christians are saying today. Here's what we're saying. Because Jesus says, here's what you're saying, all right? Here's what you say, Randy. Here's what you're saying, Laodicean Church. This is what you say. Because thou sayest, I am rich, increased with goods, have need of nothing, and knowest not. That's what we say. I'm okay. The preaching is for so-and-so. The preaching's for that person. The preaching's for this person. No. There better be sometimes the preaching or the teaching's for me. Look, when I read my devotions, I never say to myself, oh, man, God, you missed it. That was supposed to be for my wife, who's still sleeping right now. Isn't it amazing? You would change our lives if we came into church every service saying, God, speak to me. Speak to me. Now, I know sometimes we have a burden for a lost person. Oh, and people have come and preached, so my friend's here, and they're not saved. Pray for them. Or I've had this hundreds of times. Preacher, friends here, they want to see a cartwheel. They cheat. They come tell me before, right? And I know we do all that kind of stuff. We do a little cheating and we do that stuff. But when it's all said and done, boy, we ought to beg that God will tell us the truth about ourselves. Because here's the fact. I believe sometimes the devil's lies about me rather than God's truth about me. The devil sometimes has got me convinced that I'm doing okay. I am rich. I am increased with goods. I've been at this a long time. I've been saved for a long time. I read my Bible every day. I have a prayer life. I have a good marriage. I have a good home. I have this. I'm all that, Bussy. I'm good. I'm doing great. You're doing good too, man. I look at you. Man, we're all right. We don't need this. And God says, stop. Hold on a second. Let me tell you the truth about you, Randy Dignan. Here's the truth. You say you're increased with goods. You say you're rich. You say you have need of nothing. But here's the deal. You are wretched, miserable, poor, blind, and naked. Whoa. Wait a minute, God. You want the truth or don't want the truth? You find out the truth about yourself. God will sometimes, don't miss this now, disrobe our carnality so that our spirituality can be revealed. God will disrobe our carnality so that our spirituality is revealed. Not for the church, but for him. By the way, it does sometimes have an impact on the rest of the church. Your pastor is not ashamed to tell you. Your pastor is not ashamed to tell you that he goes to the altar on a regular basis. My wife travels me all the time. On conferences and camps, when another preacher preaches, go to the altar. It's something I just feel like I need to do. I don't hear as much preaching as you do. I need preaching. I'm wicked. I deserve to go to hell. And God saved me. So, there's something special about that altar. You find out the truth about yourself, all right? This is important. Number two, I'm going to give you the number one reason in just a second. Number two, And this wasn't, I added this, so this might not be in the outline that the deaf got and stuff, but it's response. It shows God you're listening. It shows God you're responding. And can I just say something right now? The church needs to be more responsive as a whole. We need to be more responsive. And yeah, I would love more amens and more shoutings and more excitement and all that stuff, but we need. I don't care about that as much as I do responsive to God. We need to be responsive, to God. As I said earlier, when I tell my children to do something or I expect something from them, guess what? There has to be some kind of response. My wife and I, we tease a lot. I hate it when she doesn't answer my phone calls. She'll turn her phone on silent overnight. I get it. I'm okay with that. But then she doesn't turn it back on. Some of you husbands are nudging your wives right now because I know exactly, you know exactly how I feel. I was sharing this with Dave Bishop. He goes, oh, I told my wife many times, if you don't answer the phone, I'm going to take your phone and throw it into the toilet, okay? And I'm a plumber, right? And Brother Bussy and I even talk about this. I'm not going to throw anybody under the bus, literally. But and then sometimes she won't turn it on until 3 o'clock in the afternoon. I've been calling her since 8 a.m. Oh, babe, I'm sorry, my phone was on silent. I missed 11 calls from you. What's up? You alive? And she acts like there's nothing wrong with it. I have made this statement before to my wife. I'm going to give the phone to the kids. Or here's what we do a lot of times. I'll call Grant or Clara on their iPods or iPad and say, please tell mommy to answer her phone. Yeah, mom, dad's trying to call you, right? Listen, I'm not throwing my wife under the bus. She's an amazing wife. She's a wonderful wife. But we're all about the truth tonight. Watch this now. Here's the deal, though. Many times we put our phone on silent and God's calling. We do. Or we have this new ring technology. Jesus is knocking at the door. We look on our phones and our camera. I love the ring stuff. Every time I go up to a ring door, I put my thumb on the camera so they can't see who it is. I do that all the time, man. And I enjoy doing that, right? Stay with me now. Hey, we put our phones on silent, and God's like wanting a response. Look at Revelation 3, verse 20. And we use this verse sometimes for salvation, and I'm not totally opposed to that. I can see the application maybe. Look at verse 20. Behold, I stand at the door and knock. If any man hear my knock, is that what the Bible says? What? But I thought he was knocking. Isn't it amazing? He actually isn't worried about you hearing his knock. He wants you to hear his what? His voice. He's calling you by name. Randy, I know you're in there. Randy, I know you're in there. Hey, Randy, I know you're in there. I know you're in there. I'm out here. And by the way, isn't it sad that he was on the front porch of Laodicea when he should be inside already? The altar is a great time, great place sometimes to make sure you are answering his voice. It sends a signal corporately and individually unto God. I'm going to show you number 3 to me is the most important reason, I think. But look at verse 20 again. Behold, I stand at the door and knock. If any man hear my voice and open the door, that's response. I will come into him and will sup with him and he with me. I will come into him. I will come in. I will come in. Did you hear that? Wow. He comes in. He meets us at the altar. He meets us at those altars, whether it's, again, at home. And again, I'm going to challenge you again. As a Christian, it's a good thing to do it at church. Well, I don't do it because, you know, man looks on the outward appearance. That's another reason why you should. It shows the church body. It shows the next generation. That message spoke to me. I'm 70. I'm 102 years old. But bless God, I'm going to try to get to the altar every once in a while to show this young person I'm not too good to not go to the altar, right? There's something significant about that. And here's number 3, and here's the number 1 reason why I think the altar is important in church. You ready for this? It gives you a chance and gives me a chance to stand against our pride. Pride. I'm more and more convinced the longer I'm a Christian, the more I study the Bible, that God hates nothing more than pride. Pride is the number 1 thing I think God hates in the Bible. He hates pride. What is the middle letter of the word pride? I. Pride was the downfall of Satan. Pride was the downfall. You can trace almost every single thing in the Bible of the people that failed, fell down, got back up, back to pride. America is being destroyed by our pride and arrogance. In my life, anytime I've had disagreements, foolish disagreements, whether it was a fuss with my wife or a fuss with a preacher or a fuss with someone in this church, I could trace it back to pride. And there's something about going to the altar. And look at verse number 20 again. It says, behold, I stand at the door and knock. Look at verse number 21. To him that overcometh, will I grant to sit with me in my throne, even as I also overcame and am set down with my Father in his throne. He that hath an ear, let him hear what the Spirit saith in the churches. When I stand up and I walk to an altar, I am screaming at pride, you are not going to win today. Because every day, Randy Dignan has this pride, and I probably have more pride than a lot of people. My wife can testify to that. And this ugly animal called pride starts sticking its head up, and I've tried to kill it, and I've tried to destroy it. But guess what? Every day, my flesh gives birth to it all over again. And I'll wake up tomorrow morning, and pride will still be there, and pride will be hanging around, and pride will try to dominate, and pride will try to dictate. And that's why I get mad on the road sometimes, and that's why I get frustrated at things in life, and that's why I didn't get my way. Pride, pride, pride. And there's something about having that altar time, whether it's in a house in the morning or alone, or if it's at a conference with 2,000 teenagers around, something about going to that altar where I stand up and I'm taking a bold stand, and it may not even be for God, but the pride itself is saying, pride, you lost right now. You lost, pride. And Satan, you lost too. I don't care what these eyeballs think. I don't care what they're thinking in their mind. Ooh, Brother Randy's at the altar. I don't care about any of those things because my pride says, stay in your seat. Stay comfortable. Stay this. Stay that. Don't be changed. Don't respond. And sometimes I want to look at my pride and say, pride, shut up. Shut up, pride. Today you lose. I hate pride. God, there's very few things in the Bible God resists, but the Bible tells us specifically that God resisteth what? What? He hates pride. The abominations of Proverbs. Guess what's on that list? Pride. Pride. Man, my pride gets up all the time. It wakes up before my spirit wakes up every morning, it feels like. Pride just ready to take the day. It's all about you, Big Daddy. It's all about you, Randy. This is Randy Dignan, and the earth and the moon and the sun. Everything revolves around you. And my pride wants to get its way. And pride is an ugly animal. Pride is a monster. Pride is a devouring creature. Pride causes the gossip. Pride causes me to sin. Pride, pride, pride. And when I fall before God on my face and my knees, whether it's in my quiet time alone and before the sun even comes up, or it's late at night, or if it's in my car and alone with tears streaming on my face, or if it's right here at a Bible Baptist Church altar or at an altar at a camp somewhere, there's something about pride. Pride hates it when I come to that altar. Pride backs away and leaves me alone for a while. Thank God for that victory I get for that moment. The Laodicean church is full of pride. The rights of the people. What have you done for me lately? Pride. I didn't get my way, pride. But what about me, pride? You didn't meet my needs, pride. I don't have a seat at the table, pride. It's always pride, pride, pride. Fight that. There's something about an altar that says, pride, you lose. And the opposite of pride is what Miss Paulette said in Milk. Humility. It's a humbling move to stand up from where you're at, a comfortable pew, and come to an old-fashioned altar and get on your knees or fall on your face and say, God, here I am again. You know my failures and my weaknesses, and I need you today. My pride got me in trouble again, and I need your help. Thank you for being a good God. Forgive me. And may I stand up one more time and go back to my life combating the enemy of pride. Pride. Isn't it interesting that the first five churches, I'm just about through, the first five churches had good and bad said about them. The church of Ephesus, Thyatira, Smyrna, Pergamos. Philadelphia, the sixth church, had nothing bad said and all good. Laodicea had all bad and nothing good said about them. And I've heard preachers say that, but it hit me one time. It actually doesn't say all bad, because he does say, here's a good thing. If I knock and hear my voice, I'll come in. But I believe the reason Laodicea really struck a nerve with Jesus Christ was because it was a church full of pride. And it's 2022. Americans are a proud people. God's not an American, remember. We think we're all that. We really are rich, and we're increased with goods. We have the best houses on the planet, and the best cars, and the best roads, and the best medical care. And we're the best at everything. We win the most gold medals. We're in the Olympics. We are just, America's the bomb. Even with the president we have right now, we're still the best. We're still the best. We're all that. And God yawns and says, look at Babylon. Look at Syria. Look at Rome. Look at Germany. Look at all the great empires that came and left. And they started to fall when they got full of pride. Stay broken. Stay humble. Stay at the altar. Stay at the altar. Heads are bowed, eyes are closed. Thank you for listening so well. Hello, Pastor Randy Dignan here of Bible Baptist Church in Jefferson City, Missouri. I'm going to take a moment and express to you what our main vision and purpose is of this ministry. You see, much of this world today has a question. It's a question that was asked in John chapter 3 by one person. It's a question that is asked by the masses, but when you really think about it, it's really a question we all have to come to grips with, face to face with, one-on-one in our lives, sometime in our life. The question is this: where will I spend eternity? And that question was asked by a religious leader by the name of Nicodemus in John chapter 3. He approached Jesus Christ in the middle of the night and had a question about spiritual matters. Well, good thing for Nicodemus, he came to the right person at the right time, because Jesus Christ is the answer in spiritual matters. You see, many of us have questions about that, and man has tried in many of its efforts to answer that question with their own ideas and philosophies. We've tried to come up with ideas on how to get us to heaven, how to confirm our way to heaven. But the fact is, we got to find out what God says about eternal things. And that's why asking Jesus Christ that question is so vital, because when you ask Jesus a question, you get the answer. And as the question was asked, Jesus answered simply this: ye must be born again. In John chapter 3, that's what he said to Nicodemus, and that's the same thing he says to you and to me, even today. You see, God is God of this universe, but he's not everybody's father. What does that have to do with John chapter 3? Well, think about this. We all have birthdays. We all are physically born onto this physical planet, or else you wouldn't be able to watch me, or I wouldn't be able to sign to you right now or talk to you at this time. But God, being a spiritual being, knew that though our bodies are temporal, our spiritual part of us, our spiritual anatomy of us, is an eternal thing. And so God says, I'm more concerned about the spiritual issues. So that's why he sent his son, Jesus Christ, to die on the cross for you and me 2,000 years ago and live again 3 days later, so that you and I can have a spiritual birthday and know for sure that heaven is our home. Well, that leads to the next question. Why do we need a spiritual birthday? Well, it's simple. We're all sinners. We've all broken God's law and God's commands. But God loves us so much so that he let Jesus Christ become the substitute for your sin and my sin, so that if we recognize and admit that we are sinners, we can then trust in Jesus Christ as our substitute, and more so than that, our personal Savior, and know that on top of our physical birthdays, we have a spiritual birthday now, in that God becomes our Father, we become his sons, daughters, we become his children, and we know we're going to go to heaven someday. My friend, it's very simple. It's not about what the church says, what I have ideas about, or what you have ideas about. It's finding out what God says directly to you and me. And he did it right there in the Bible, and in particular, John chapter 3, when Jesus says, ye must be born again. If our church can help you with that question, if you have any questions about that, we can give you some answers. We'd be glad to help you in any way we can. Again, Pastor Randy, personally thanking you for watching the message. And again, if there's anything we can do for you, let us know. God bless, and make it a great day.